The sheer presence of DNA that's claimed to be hundreds of thousands, if not millions of years old, argues against the hundreds of thousands to millions of years.
Okay.
DNA breaks down very quickly. It's attacked by oxygen. It's attacked by water. It can form knots and snap. It's attacked by all sorts of things. I mean, bacteria and fungi would eat DNA.
Hmm.
And so when you find a bone in the dirt, well, there's bacteria and fungi living in that bone.
Yeah.
And it's been rained on. And oxygen's probably there. If not, it's still water present. Ice crystals destroy DNA.
Hmm.
And so we find the oldest supposed organism with DNA that's intact is found in the polar regions, in cold areas. We don't really find much in Africa where it's hot.
Okay. And that's because cold preserves DNA. Because
cold preserves it, but only to a limit. It doesn't last forever. Now, you can probably ask me next, well, how long does it last?
Yeah.
I anticipate that, right? Is that what you're going to say? We don't necessarily know. We can measure in the short term. So the oldest DNA that's claimed to be found is over a million years old.
Hmm.
They pull it out of an organism, sequence them. It's only little pieces. They're not sequencing entire genomes, but they're able to pull out pieces of DNA, sequence them, say, okay, this is what the woolly mammoth or the ancient horse or the cave bear, this is their DNA, and this is what their genome might have been like.
Hmm.
But we don't know how old that stuff really is. And based on DNA decay rates, there shouldn't be any DNA there. So you're probably wondering, how do we measure the DNA decay rate? Well, we actually can't. We can measure over the short term in the laboratory, but how do you extrapolate that to hundreds of thousands of years? So the one study that I know of that tried to do this, they used ancient moa bones from New Zealand.
Yeah.
They carbon dated the moa bones.
Big bird, right?
Yeah, giant bird. They carbon dated the bones, and then they measured all the pieces of DNA that were in the bones and how long they were.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a decay curve of how fast DNA breaks down over time. Okay. Based on that, there's no way you're going to find DNA in something like a million-year-old animal, even in permafrost.
Okay.
You definitely never find it in like a dinosaur.
Okay.
Because they supposedly died out 65 million years ago. There's no way there's DNA there, but there's biochemical evidence of DNA. There's microscopic evidence of DNA in dinosaurs.
Hmm.
We don't have sequence data yet because the pieces, I mean, that stuff, if the dinosaurs died in Noah's flood, that's 4,500 years old. That's really, really, really old for DNA. It should be almost all broken down, but there's some left in some cases. I know of at least two groups that are chasing dinosaur DNA. Someone's going to do it eventually. It's just difficult. Because when you pull a dinosaur bone out of the dirt, it's full of modern bacteria and modern fungi.
Hmm.
And the amount of DNA from those organisms way overwhelms the little bit of trace amounts of ancient DNA that might be present.
Before we continue, quick heads up, stick around until the end of the interview, because for a limited time, we'll be offering an exclusive free stream of Dr. Carter's popular presentation, Ancient DNA. It covers a lot of this info in even more depth. You won't want to miss it. Now back to the discussion. So are you saying that we could get Jurassic Park soon? Because I would like to go to that.
Man, I would too, but no, it's not going to happen.
Okay.
There is a team in Japan that's working on cloning the woolly mammoth. And they've got millions of dollars and they're working on it and they're making some progress, but they're not actually going to clone the mammoth because the mammoth genome is broken down. It's in pieces. You can't just take the DNA out of a mammoth cell and stick it into an elephant egg cell, say, and make it a mammoth. So what they're going to do is they know the genome of the mammoths. Okay, that's the gene for the hairiness. That's the one that makes the big tusks. This gene might affect the funny shape of their head. And they're going to genetically engineer an elephant with those traits and then try to put that egg into a female elephant and have her give birth to what looks like a woolly mammoth.
Got it.
But you can't do that with dinosaurs.
Hmm.
See, woolly mammoth is an elephant. So you can change the elephant DNA to make it look more like a woolly mammoth. What's like a dinosaur?
Hmm.
Nothing.
Yeah.
There's no comparable species that you can manipulate to resurrect a dinosaur. So it's not actually going to happen. But someday we're going to have dinosaur DNA. It's just a technical question of who's going to do it first and what's the best specimen to use. It's going to happen, but that dinosaur DNA will contradict the age of the bones.
Okay.
Now, I said a minute ago that they use carbon dating to date the moa bones.
That's right, yeah. And I know that we have a lot of materials here at CMI about carbon dating.
A lot of things. In fact, in my article, How Carbon Dating Works on creation.com, I have a chart of how as you go further back in time, the carbon dates start leaving the historical dates. The carbon dates are older than the historical dates. Hmm. And I suspect that the closer to the flood you get, the more they diverge from reality.
And we're talking about historical dates of things artifacts that we can pretty reliably verify.
Yeah, the destruction layer at Jericho or a pharaoh's sarcophagus. In fact, the Willard Libby, who invented carbon dating, he validated his technique on Egyptian coffins.
Hmm.
And he said, it's the strangest thing. The oldest coffins that I'm using diverge more from the expected date than the younger ones.
Okay.
And so there's more. I really think that the closer to the flood you get, you're going to get an escalation of the carbon dates because, well, there's some carbon-14 in dinosaur bones, a little bit.
Yeah.
Well, that's telling us that there's a little bit of carbon-14 before the flood. There's a lot more now because as the Earth's magnetic field collapses, as we see, as, you know, all sorts of other reasons for expecting carbon-14 to change over time. Creation.com is a great resource, everybody. When you look at an ancient moa bone, it has less carbon-14 than it should based on its age.
Okay.
So it has an apparent older age than its true historical age.
Right.
So not only, if you just take the evolutionary estimates, DNA breaks down too fast to get a million-year-old sample with any DNA. We know that now. Okay, great. But if you put the biblical constraints on it and you crunch down those carbon dates, it's even worse. Because the true breakdown rate is much, much, much faster than they want to acknowledge.
Hmm.
So in our model, hey, we're going to find some DNA of a dinosaur. Great. That fits the biblical time frame.
Yeah.
But barely. It's really hard to get it. But if they find dinosaur DNA and they claim it's, you know, 70 million years old or so, no, it's not.
It doesn't work at all.
Yeah. So ancient DNA puts a limit on how old the Earth can be.
Dr. Carter, I know you talk about a lot of this stuff in ancient DNA.
Oh, yeah.
And for our watching audience, we do have a special offer for a limited time. Your DVD, Ancient DNA, is going to be free to stream.
Stream.
Tell us about that.
As a geneticist, I want to know how to handle this brand new field of ancient DNA. And a lot of people are very confused about it. But there's so many amazing things. There's a dark time in human history.
Mm-hmm.
Between the flood and the establishment of civilizations, there's sometimes 1,000 years or more where nothing was ever written down.
Hmm.
We actually don't know what happened there. We have, you know, a campfire. We might have a mud brick house or a, you know, a small scale city or something like that. But they didn't leave writing. So we can only infer who came from where and who's related to whom and things like that. Well, now that we're able to pull DNA out of the ground, out of ancient bones, we can now tell the story of that missing time period.
Hmm.
And it is absolutely fascinating.
Wow.
We can see people migrating across the world. We can see, you know, Neanderthals coming into the fold. Neanderthals are now Homo sapiens. I mean, you and I carry Neanderthal DNA.
Yeah.
In fact, you and I carry 2-3% Neanderthal DNA.
Oh, okay.
Which doesn't sound like a lot until you realize that means that for every one of your ancestors, every 100 ancestors you have, 2 or 3 of them were a Neanderthal.
Huh.
Oh. That makes us them and them us. It's like the Neanderthal population just kind of blended into the later migrants who moved up into Eurasia. They were the first people that got up into Eurasia after the flood.
Okay.
And later on, other people moved in and they mingled, which is why we carry their DNA. We didn't know that 20 years ago. We had no idea when the first Neanderthal DNA was starting to be sequenced. Oh, these things aren't human, haha. Well, that's not true anymore, because now we got better and more sequences, and they're clearly human.
Wow.
We didn't know that. So I'm explaining this to the audience. This is one of my favorite things I've ever done, because I love history, love genetics, love genealogy, and I love the Bible. And put all those things together, and we have this presentation called Ancient DNA.
And remember, for a limited time, we are going to make Ancient DNA free to stream. Link in the description below. Dr. Carter, thank you so much for your time.
Oh, Sheridan, I'm afraid we've only scratched the surface. Every one of these things we talked about, there's so much more to talk about. I love this conversation. I hope people watch this, and I hope people go to creation.com to learn so much more.